Some of my earliest remembrances of the Bible, the Word of God, take me back to my grandparents in a little old two-room log cabin. The floor was slanted in the center. And I remember when they would place their bed or their cupboard over next to the wall, they'd have to get some little blocks of wood and put under two of the legs to keep it, if it has on wheels especially, keep it from rolling to the center of the room. But the thing that I remember so much about it was my grandmother with a big open Bible on her lap. I used to walk down a long dirt road to get to their house, and sometimes I'd spend the weekend, and I remember, kid-like, I got a kick out of trying to scare her. She didn't know I was around, and I'd open the door and yell and scream like a crazy person. And I remember several times going down to the end of this long dirt road and looking through the window, and there my dear grandmother with a big family Bible open on her lap reading the Word of God. I remember my dad religiously every day of his life going to his bedroom and reading the Word of God. I remember him taking the family together, and we would read, and then Dad would sing a song. Now, Dad couldn't sing. When he sang Asaph, Lord, the flag in heaven, to half mast, when my dad began to sing. But the songs that he sang, I remember they were spiritual songs. And I remember my dad taking me to church, and I remember sitting under the ministry of people like Dr. Oliver Green as a young kid. Back then, you never questioned the inerrancy of the Scriptures. You never heard the authority of the Scriptures questioned. Back then, everybody just believed that the Bible was the Word of God, and they either believed it or they were agnostic or atheist, and there were no gray areas there. You either believed it or you didn't believe it. But times have certainly changed, because today there's so many gray areas. Many people think they're believing when in reality they're not, because there are so many versions today that are not in actuality the Word of God. I'm glad the Lord raises up people to defend His Word and to defend His work. And among those is Sister Gail Riplinger. We appreciate her. I have noted on different internet areas, she's the topic of conversation. I brought her a web address tonight of someone that is not on that page that lists all of her closest friends. They're not particularly on that page. But Dr. Lakin used to say years ago that if you don't want anybody to bother you, have nothing, know nothing, and do nothing. But he said if you want to do something, you can expect them to get after you. But he said as long as people are kicking you in the rear, you know you're out in front. And I think that's a pretty good philosophy of life. I know here we've tried to clearly take a stand down through the years for the Word of God and standards and so forth. And people in this city, they either love us or hate us. There's no gray area. But I'd rather it be that way. I don't want to be a I want to go on record. I don't want to be a compromising liberal. I want people to know that I believe the Bible, the King James Version, is the Word of God. I say that without apology. It's worked in my life, my family's life. I'm just too old now to even think about doing anything different. And if I was still 19, like some of you folks, I still wouldn't change. Because when you got a hold of the truth, you don't need to get rid of it. You don't need to change it and alter it. And you don't need to join the Bible a Month Club to see what they're coming out with next month if you've got a hold of the truth of the Word of God. The truth will set you free. It's the other crowd that'll put you in bondage. And we want to just uphold the truth. And I have these people in to just verify what I've been preaching all along. We've had Brother Jules Smith here. He'll be back with us in September of this year. And then, of course, we have our dear sister and her family with us tonight. I know you want to hear what she has to say. So I want you to give her your undivided attention. When she finishes, we're going to have a question and answer session. She asked me how long should she speak. I said, well, we've got all the way to midnight, so far as I know, and you just preach, or not preach, she don't preach. She does that at home, but she's going to come tonight and share with us the things that the Lord has given. Come on, Sister Riplinger, and preach to us tonight, will you?
You want that hand to help, Mike?
Push that one button up right there if you need it.
Okay. God has said he has magnified his word above all his name. And what we're going to be doing tonight is magnifying the word. This is a magnifying glass here. And we're going to be taking a very close look at the word of God. There's another verse that says, let us magnify the Lord together. So we're going to be magnifying the word. The closer you get to Jesus Christ, the more lovely he is. And the closer you get to the word of God, looking at the individual words, the more lovely it is. Now, that only works with the King James Bible, obviously. But I heard a story about a young man who was in prison. And he was tested for a GED test. He wanted to take the General Educational Development test because he wanted to get his high school diploma when he was in prison. So they did a pretest on the young man, and he tested at the fifth grade reading level, which is exactly what the King James Bible is. Now, he wasn't able to get into that class because the class was full. And so he got saved in the interim, and he was reading a King James Bible for about a year. Finally, the class opened up. There was a space for him, and they pre-tested him again at his reading level. And he was reading at the 17th grade level, which would be postgraduate. And so I heard that story, and I wondered in my mind, how did that young man, without a library, without a lot of dictionaries, without anyone teaching him anything, how did he go from the 5th grade reading level to the 17th grade reading level? That would be a very unusual occurrence under any circumstances. And it dawned on me that perhaps through reading the King James Bible, the Lord had expanded his vocabulary and just raised his reading level, his intelligence level, and all that sort of thing, from becoming a new creature and from reading the King James Bible. So I started examining the King James Bible. You know, all of us, after we realize that the King James Bible is the true Word of God for the English-speaking people, very often we hear from our friends, they will acquiesce to that notion, but they will say, well, the King James is hard to understand. It's got some big words in it, all that sort of thing. And when they say that, I think, well, perhaps it does have some big words, because he did go from the 5th grade reading level to the 17th, so something must, you know, there must be some words in the King James at the 17th grade reading level, okay? And so I made a list of what I considered to be the 1,000 most difficult words in the King James Bible. I made a list of words that I either wasn't sure of myself, or that I thought my 10-year-old daughter might not understand. So I used that as my criteria. And I looked up each of those words in their first usage, okay? And what I discovered was phenomenal. And it just absolutely blew my mind. I discovered that in the first usage of these 1,000 words, God had defined each and every word using the very exact words of the Webster's Dictionary, or the Oxford English Dictionary, or a standard dictionary. Now, he didn't do it, you know, 499 times or 899 times. He did it all 1,000 times, and all 1,000 times he used the very words of the Webster's Dictionary, defining the word in its first usage. And so I'm creating a book. It's going to be called The Bible's Built-In Dictionary. But I'd like to share with you tonight how you can find that built-in dictionary yourself. And when you run into a hard word, using that dictionary, and then also some of the other tips I'll be giving you on finding the Bible. Basically, this is sort of an English lesson. Women, as the pastor said, do not teach or preach the Bible. They don't teach the Bible, but I can teach English, and I guess I can do probably what a clerk would do in a Christian bookstore. I can point you to a Bible. If someone said, where is a Bible? I can say, this is the Bible. So tonight we'll have an English lesson. You know, the Bible says, thy word is very pure, therefore thy servant loveth it. And the purer we understand the word of God to be, the more we will love the Bible. Now, to find the Bible's built-in dictionary, first look at the word in its first usage. You'll find the first usage of any word in the Bible in a Strong's Concordance. Okay, but if you just start at Genesis, you'll just naturally follow along with this. So if you read through the Bible every year, this will be a natural occurrence for you. But let's take a somewhat difficult word like abroad. Okay, that isn't a word that we use today. But the Oxford English Dictionary, and that will be listed over in this column here, the Oxford English Dictionary defines abroad as spread. So when you look in Genesis chapter 10, verse 18, the very word next to abroad is spread. Okay. Now, I found this to happen 1,000 times, and I'll show you just a few to prove to you what I found. The word adamant, for instance. The Webster's Dictionary defines adamant as a very hard stone. Can everyone see that? Do I have it where you can all see it? As a very hard stone. Okay. When we look at the first usage of the word adamant in Ezekiel 3:9, the very word next to adamant is harder. Okay, so God has given us one of the qualifiers for the word adamant. Okay, in Zechariah, he gives us the word stone. Okay, so my recommendation to you is look at the word that is precisely next to the word you don't understand, and very likely that will give you the definition for that word. Genesis chapter 26, the word charge. We don't use the word charge too often anymore. Okay, the first usage of charge says, my charge, my commandments. Webster says that the word command is a synonym to charge. Okay, the word chaste, we don't often hear that word. Okay, the word chaste. Another dictionary defines it as virginal. The word next to the very first usage of the word chaste is virginal. Okay, I'll move down a little bit. The word chapman. Now, that's a word we do not use today. Chapman is defined by the Oxford English Dictionary as a merchant. Okay? Actually, that's where we get the word cheap from, cheap man. Okay? But the word right next to Chapman in the Bible is merchant. So you really didn't have to know what a Chapman was. You just had to know what a merchant was. Okay? Here's another archaic word, durst. Okay, Esther 7:5, the first usage of the word durst in the Bible is defined in the dictionary as presume. So next to the word durst, we have the word presume. Okay, now if you can't find the definition in the very next word, look elsewhere in that verse, and I'll give you some examples. The word amend. The Oxford English Dictionary says it means to repair. The very next word is to repair. Okay? Abesum. We don't use that word today, besom. But the OED defines besom as sweep. And right in the verse, we have, I will sweep it with the besom. So the definition, the dictionary's definition is right in that verse there. Okay, well, perhaps you don't know one of the words. Maybe you'll know the next word, deride. The Oxford English Dictionary defines deride as to scoff or to scorn. Both of those words are in the very first usage, right in the verse. Deride means to scoff or to scorn. Now, there's another phenomena that I discovered as I was going through this. God uses parallelisms, okay? He will repeat the same sentence structure, the same part of speech, to help you find that word. If it's somewhere else in the verse, he'll help you find it. For instance, I will extol thee, thou hast lifted me. Okay, the definition of extol, which is kind of a hard word, in the OED, is to lift up. Okay, write a part of that verse, there it is, lift up. Now, to help you find that, he's got a one-syllable word, another one-syllable word, another one syllable and another one syllable. They're both the same parts of speech. One's the subject, verb, verb. Extol and lifted. They're both the verbs, okay? Now here's a difficult word, execration. no one knows what an execration is. I certainly don't. But the Webster's Dictionary says it means a curse. So the very first usage of execration in Jeremiah says that it's a curse. So we really didn't need a dictionary or a college degree or anything to figure that out. God put that right in the Bible for us. Okay, now what if God uses a word to define a word and you don't know what either of the words mean? Because sometimes that will happen, okay? Dissimulation. It's a difficult word, okay? Dissimulation means dissembleth. Well, that doesn't do me any good either, okay? So I'm still in trouble. The Lord hasn't helped me out of that mess. Now, what's he going to do? Okay, because the OED says dissimulation means dissembling. Well, there's dissembling right there, but I still don't know what dissembling means, okay? So for the dummies like myself, he will go down in the next verse, in verse 14, and he said, not truth. Okay, it's not truth. It's in the very next verse. Now, let's go to the very first time dissembleth occurs in the Bible. He fills that verse with words that mean not truth. Covered, deceit, deceived. When you look in the dictionary, Webster's Unabridged or Oxford, deceive or cover. You'll see right in the context there, deceive, cover, deceive, cover. He puts it all over the place. He sort of beats it into our head. He knows we're probably daydreaming through half the verse, so somewhere we'll get deceived somewhere on that verse. Okay. Now, the Global Bible Society is a printer of King James Bible, and I'm sure they're very fine people, but unfortunately, some of the printers of the King James have started to change some words, and I would recommend that they not do that, because betwixt, they have changed betwixt to between, thinking that, you know, we wouldn't understand what betwixt means, but the very first usage of betwixt in the Bible gives the definition between, betwixt or between. So it's all right there. We really don't have to change the word. We can just expand our vocabulary a little bit. Okay, now, if you cannot find the definition looking at the next word or looking within the verse or the verse above or the verse below, look in the chapter or just go up to the paragraph mark. A paragraph mark is a little P that's sort of backwards with some lines in it. Okay. Now what I have found is 80% of the words in the Bible are defined either in the verse above, or in the verse below. So most words you do not have to go through all the chapter looking for them. But let's just say there are a few that you do. Okay. Look in Genesis chapter 8, the word abated. Okay. Now if we don't know what abated means, God has given us about five synonyms there in the very first usage for abated. It means stopped, it means restrained, it means returned, it means decreased. It means all of those things. And he figures out of those five, we would at least know one of them. Now, these definitions are all the very definitions given in the dictionary. Okay? Now, blains. Exodus 9:9. The Oxford Dictionary of English Etymology defines a blain as a boil breaking forth. Okay, in fact, they use the very words of the Bible. Now, one might say, why does the Bible have the definition the Bible was written before the dictionary? Well, actually, the Bible created the English language, okay? English really wasn't English until the late 1500s, the early 1600s. And with the use of the King James Bible and the colonization with the British Empire, they took that Bible all around the world. And those definitions that God implanted in the Bible became the definitions in the culture. Very many people used to learn to read all around the world, in America as well, using a King James Bible. That became a part of the culture. And when someone creates a dictionary, the only thing they do to create that dictionary is look and see what the culture is saying. They will get something like the Brown Corpus of English Literature. They will take a word, they will look at 10 words before that word, 10 words after that word, and see how that word was used. They'll gather a bunch of these together, and they'll look and say, well, usually people use this word in this way, so it must mean this. And so when Webster's and Oxford English Dictionary went to put their dictionaries together, they looked to see how words were used in the culture, and they were used as the Bible had sort of indoctrinated the culture to think about them. So God really created the Bible. You know, it isn't the other way around. Okay, now once in a while, there'll be a hard word. God will take a whole chapter to define that word. We'll take the word expedient, okay? Now, expedient simply means when you break down the etymology of it, to free the feet. Okay? Expedient. Now, when you look at John chapter 11, which is the very first time the word expedient is used, you will see that that whole chapter is about freeing the feet. That's what the chapter is about. Now, the dictionary is going to tell us that it's about freeing the feet, but the chapter is going to tell us it's about freeing the feet. Okay? First, we see Mary wiped Jesus' feet. Later, she fell down at his feet in that chapter. Lazarus bound, feet were loose, and Jesus was going to die for us and be our substitute. Therefore, it said in that chapter, he could walk no more. Okay? Because a secondary definition of expedient is for. So you'll find in that chapter the word for used a number of times. He died for us. Okay? So they were walking. He was going to die for us. And so he could walk no more openly. So the whole chapter is about feet and walking and whether they're bound or whether they're loose. And so the word expedient just means to free the feet. So if you don't know what expedient means, you would get the drift from just looking at the chapter. Now, you might ask, well, if God's got two words in the same sentence that mean the very exact same thing, why would he do that? Why wouldn't he just use one word? Why would he want to expand our vocabulary? What could possibly benefit us by expanding our vocabulary with all these words? In other words, why don't we just get rid of the old one or the hard one or the bad one that we don't understand and just keep the simple one? And I'll give you a few reasons. Number one, he wanted to make sure that the reader is not misunderstanding something. In other words, if he repeats something twice, we're not going to misunderstand it. Okay. I think the other reason is he wants to define words in case they fall out of use. And so the definition is built right into the verse. Also, he may want to compensate for regional variations because in England, a headache could be called a head warch in some areas. It's called a skull ache in some other parts of England. They call it all sorts of different things. And so you will notice in America there are a lot of regional variations, and there are still variations of English within the world today, the English-speaking world. But I think essentially the reason he's done it, or from what I've found from my study, is that he wants to increase our vocabulary to increase the available linguistic tools. Now let me explain to you what I mean by linguistic tools. One linguistic tool would be something called alliteration. Okay, alliteration, just you can look inside the word and see what it is. Litter, letter. Okay, he's going to repeat letters so that it will be poetic, like the fowls were filled with their flesh. Okay. Now, children can memorize the King James Bible because it's got alliteration all through it. You can't memorize an NIV because it probably said the chickens had spaghetti for supper. Do you know what I'm saying? It isn't going to be the same way. But the fowls were filled with their flesh. Okay. Or in Job, when he was talking about the collar of his coat. Okay. The two C words are called alliteration. Now, if you called it a jacket instead of a coat, you know, so can you see he's got to have more words for a coat than just a coat? You know, someplace the J word might be more poetic or work out a little bit better. Now, I took, you can do this with absolutely any verse in the Bible, absolutely any verse, but I just took one absolutely by random, and I said, I'm going to just work on this verse and work on it and see what I can find and what's going on here in terms of linguistic tools, okay? Alliteration, okay, just in Revelation 3:18 alone, we have appear with the A sound, anoint, counsel clothed, tried, fire, wretched, rich, and raiment. Okay? Now, the reason it's good to have things that sound the same is the same reason aesthetically it's good to have your clothes match. You know, a purple pants, orange tie, green ribbon, polka dots, plaid, it doesn't really work. Well, when you're creating something that's aesthetically beautiful, you need repetition of elements. You know what I mean? A blue shirt and a blue top, and there's repetition. Creates unity. Unity creates associative meanings, and you enhance the meaning of things there. Now, the other tool, linguistic tool that God uses all the time, if you start to look for this, you'll find it absolutely everywhere, is rhyme. Okay, now this is still Revelation 3:18. I counsel thee to buy of me, thou mayest see, thou mayest be, thou mayest see. Okay, now I just pulled those out of that verse. Now if you just read the verse, you wouldn't pick that up at all. You wouldn't pick that rhyme up. But if you start looking for the rhyme, it's built into the verse. Then if you start trying to find out the long I sounds, I tried, white, thy eyes, the long O sounds, gold, clothed, the long A sounds, raiment, shame, naked, may, long A sounds, you can see that God has built all of these things in. Now, if I take an NIV or a New King James and I try to do these things, it absolutely doesn't work at all. So, I mean, absolutely doesn't work at all. Now, there's something in English called stress-timed rhythms. And Shakespeare used this. They're called isochronous rhythms. Basically, what it means is that at mathematically predictable intervals, there's going to be the accent on a word. Like, you know, when I say banana, the accent is on the na, banana, okay? And so God has organized the King James Bible so that this rhythm, and this is another linguistic tool, it's called rhythm, that this rhythm occurs at mathematically predictable intervals, okay? So you would have, now we're still in Revelation 3:18. I haven't moved to a different verse. Mayest be, mayest, or nakedness. Three syllables, accent on the first and third syllable. Okay, now the same verse, I counsel thee to buy of me, thou mayest be, thou mayest see. Four syllables and the accents alternate, okay? Now, if God wants to put an idea in your head together with another idea, like tried and the fire, okay? They both have long I sound, try, fi, tried and the fire. He wants to make an association in your mind, tried and the fire, or shame of thy nakedness. They're both long A sounds. Shame, it's a shame to be naked. They both sound like a long A sound. So he's making that association in your mind. Now, if you take that verse that I just went through, Revelation 3:18, you look at it in the New King James, they've got words like you, garments, put, clothes, and you try to find any sort of rhythm, alliteration, rhyme, isochronous, whatever. None of it is going on in any of these new Bible versions. Another suggestion I'll make, if you're finding a word that you can't understand, would be change the pronunciation from how you think you might pronounce it. For instance, the word coney. Okay, actually, the pronunciation of a coney is a cunny. And a cunny is a bunny. So if you were just trying a different way to pronounce it, you could figure out that a coney is really a cunny, which is really a bunny. Or beeves. Say, well, I think I'll try to pronounce that a different way. Beefs. It's really beef. Or a merce is a mercy. So try different pronunciations of words. Now, actually, when the Scottish and Irish immigrants came from Ireland and Scotland to America and settled in this part of the United States, they were using good proper English, okay? And they're still using good proper English. It's the rest of America that's gone awry, okay? So don't let anyone tell you otherwise. But, for instance, a word like beget, okay? Now that's a verb, you know, you beget someone. But what it really means, when you have an imperative case verb like beget, befall, these are all verbs, there's an implied you in front of it. So really, what that is you begetting. I mean, that's really what it is. Or the word befall, you befallen. Behold, you beholden. Beseech, you beseeking. Bemoan, you bemoaning. Belie, you belying. And a right is a right bit funny. I mean, that's really what it is. And so that is a correct usage, and the rest of America is not correctly pronouncing the English language. So let them know I told you this. Okay, now the other thing that you can do if you find a difficult word is change the spelling in your mind. And don't change it in the Bible, but just change it in your mind. Like a canker would be a cancer. A coffer, just change the R to N as a coffin. Concision is really incision. Coulter is cutlery, flipping the T and the L. A Chapman, we saw before, is a cheap man. dry shod is dry shoed. Hemorrhoid was in the Bible, it's emroids. You know, preparation H took the H and they kept it. And so the Bible just has the emroid. Okay. The other trick that you can use is to look inside words. Okay. Now, when you see a word like albeit, and you think, well, what does albeit mean? Break it up into its parts. Be it. Okay. Can you see the be in the it? Okay. Or a foot. It's about a foot. A gone is gone. A miss is miss. Backbite is bite back. Chapter is really cap. Okay, now the word chastise, this really helped me, this word, when the Lord chastises, that look at the first part of the word chastise. It's the word chaste. And chastise really simply means to make chaste. So that's a more positive way to look at being chastised when it happens to you. Centurion, look at the word sent. And it's 1 out of 100. A cent is 1 out of 100. So a centurion is a man out of 100. Dropsy is a funny word in the Old Testament. Look at the word drop. It's water drops. It's someone who has water retention. So dropsy is water retention, actually. Enchantment. See the word chant inside? Embolden. You can see the word bold inside. So look inside words, break them apart, and normally you'll find something that will help you understand that word. Now I want to show you how God uses parallelisms once again. He uses them in whole sentences. Now here we have the difficult word appertain, okay? Number 16. The very first time appertain shows up in the Bible says, the earth opened her mouth and swallowed them up, comma, with all that appertain unto them. Now, God repeats the very words that the earth opened her mouth and swallowed them up, comma. So when you see God repeating something, he's going to tell you the same thing all over again, but he's going to use different words in case you didn't understand it the first time. Comma, their house, all the men, and all their goods. So appertain must mean all their house, all the men, and all their goods. And if you didn't get it from that, you would get it from inside. The word appertain is the word pertain, and Webster says that pertain is the definition of the word. Look at the word deck. Okay, here's a parallelism. Deck thyself now with majesty and excellency. Array thyself with glory and beauty. You can line this up. These are both verbs. Deck means array. So when you look up deck in the Webster's dictionary, it's going to say array. Well, God's already put array right there. Thyself, thyself, he's repeating. With and with, he's repeating. Those are both prepositions. These are both subjects. These are both verbs. And he's repeating it, and you're going to fill in the blank, and you're going to say deck means array. Now, the other thing that God does, I found, to define words is to use their opposite. For instance, bold, okay? The Bible says in Exodus 9, the flax was bold. Well, I didn't know what bold meant, okay? But the wheat and the rye were not grown up. So, obviously, the but there in those sentences is telling me that flax is going to be, what's ever happening to the flax is the opposite of what is happening to these others. This is not up, okay? So the definition of bold, when you look over in Webster's, is puffed up, okay? Now, when you're looking for a definition, the Bible often uses what linguists call a collocational restrictions. Now, let me give you an example. If I say excruciating to you, okay, there are only 4 or 5 words that can come to your mind. You couldn't say excruciating birthday cake, you know. You couldn't say, you have to say excruciating pain, excruciating. There are certain words that our mind or the culture has built up associations with. So what the Bible does is very interesting. Take the word coming, okay. Now who knows what a coming is? You know, I don't know what a coming is, so I put that in my list, all right. Now, when I found the word in the Bible, it was with the word plowman, plow, sow, ground. And it was with all those words. And they're all of a sudden, they're talking about this coming business. Well, what I found was that 100 times, God had used the word plow, sow, and ground with the word seed. Now, this time, he's omitting the word seed. He's replacing the word coming there. So when the way a computer works is your mind is going to key in plow, sow, and ground. It's going to bring up the word seed in your mind. So if he's throwing whatever this is, he's not throwing dresses, he's not throwing cows. You know what I'm saying? That word seed is going to come up in your mind. And so you will automatically understand what that word is, even if you don't consciously or you're not consciously aware that you understand what that word is. Now, the King James Bible uses something called families of morphologically related words. For instance, ill, evil, devil, vile, villain, vilify. Okay, if a child knew what evil was, or devil, they could look at the word vile and sort of get the idea that something vile was something of the devil, or to vilify or a villain was someone who was devilish, vilify. Okay, God will build up an understanding for a young person, starting with a small word, I noticed in Genesis, and working his way up. Or a child might know the word ear, but they might not know hearken. He will start early in the Bible using the word ear, build up to the word hear, then he'll build up to the word hearken. But still, you can see the word ear inside the word hear. So that's not really a problem. For instance, I found that, we'll take a compound word like horseback. Okay, he'll define horse, or he'll define back in Genesis 14, horse in Genesis 49, and then he uses the compound word horseback in 2 Kings. So he didn't throw that on a child immediately without first giving them some definition of horse and definition of back. Now, let's take a difficult word like, acceptation. Okay, you think, why would God, you know, put a word like that in there and expect someone to understand what acceptation means? Well, what he did is he started in the book of Genesis, and he used the word accept. Okay, Leviticus, he made that a little fancier, and he said acceptable. Job, then he got archaic, and he said accepteth. Isaiah, acceptance. And it wasn't until 1 Timothy, when someone had read almost all the way through the Bible, did he use the word acceptation. So he didn't just throw it at the child or someone like that. He's building up an understanding, and he's building up a use of the English language. Remember, he's the Word. He thinks words are very important, because we think with words, don't we? Okay, now let's take a word like couch. God will start in Genesis 49:4 with a simple noun, couch. Okay? He's going to give you the OED, Oxford English Dictionary's definition of a couch, which is a bed. The primary definition of a couch is a bed in the Oxford English Dictionary. So there it is, right in the verse, a bed. Now, just so you'll get the drift that a couch is a bed, he uses possessives, father's bed, my couch. Okay? Now, just a few verses later, Genesis 49 now, he's going to make this into a verb. He's going to get a little bit more complex here. And he's going to say couched. Well, the Oxford English Dictionary says couched is to go down. Okay, well, God told us that right there. He stooped down. Now, in case we didn't catch that, he's going to use identical words. A seven-letter word here, a seven-letter word there. Stooped, couched. They not only both have seven letters, they both end ED. Okay, if we didn't catch that, he's got these ow sounds, roused, couched, to hook that together. Okay, ow, down. And then in verse 8, he's using the word bow down. So he's got all these ow sounds in all that verse. Okay. Then it isn't until verse 14, a little bit further down, that he gets into this what's called a complex verbal substantive. And he couching is a gerund or something like that. So he's building up an understanding in a child's mind of the English language. So perhaps using one of those Bibles that supposedly chronological Bible, what really happened first, if you use that exclusively, you would not be able to understand the words in the Bible, because he's really set it up exactly the way it should be. Now, the other thing I noticed that God does when I can't find a definition for something is he uses the verse numbers sometimes, not all the time, but as sort of addresses about what he's talking about. And when I was looking for the definition of divineth, I saw a pattern happening in verses 5 and 15. He was talking about dreaming, and then interpreting it. So when we get to several chapters later and we want to know what interpret dream the dream is, we've got the word divine and divineth. So looking at those verse numbers, going back in those same places through chapter 37, 40, 40, and 41, 5 and 15, he's talking about the same thing, and he's going to give you the definition. So sometimes you have to go a little bit further in your search to try to find something. Okay. Now, there's something called onomatopoeia, okay? Now, you will find that a lot of English is built from something called onomatopoeia. What that means is when I say bite, my teeth go together like I'm biting, okay? Devour. So the King James has, take heed, consume, don't bite and devour one another. When you say devour, your mouth has to get real big, devour, like you're going to devour someone. When you say bite, your mouth bites, okay? When you say murmur, that's sort of how you murmur. You know, you say murmur is a real quiet kind of a word, murmur. You know what I'm saying? So those are called onomatopoeia. If you can't figure out what something is, sometimes looking at, the word imitates what is actually happening there, like a crisping pin, okay? The New King James and the NIV have a big problem with the crisping pin. Now, let me see if you can all guess what a crisping pin is, okay? Now, think about this. The word crisp, like bacon. If you throw bacon on a grill and it goes crisp, that's where the word came from. So lots of sounds are associated. That's how, you know, language developed and all that sort of thing. Now, they have, in the New King James, instead of a crisping pin, they have a purse, okay? Well, when you look the word up in the Hebrew, it actually means an engraving tool. Now, think about this. It's talking about women in the Old Testament, and God was making fun of them, and he was saying, now, your crisping pins, you know, you're going to have problems with your crisping pins. And how many people used a crisping pin, the women, used a crisping pin to get ready today, if it was an engraving tool? How many people know what an engraving tool looks like? It's a rod with an electric cord at the end of it, and it heats up. Okay, if you want to engrave wood or like a little kid's engraving kit, you know, you get this rod, and you pss, you know, and you burn wood with it. Well, women, we use it to curl our hair. It's a curling iron, okay? But the translators on the NIV and New King James could not figure out what a woman would be doing with a engraving tool in their purse, okay? So they said, well, maybe it's a purse. It must be a purse. So when you look up in the Hebrew thing, it'll say, well, by implication, it must be a purse. Maybe they took a engraving tool and they dug a hole and they put their stuff in it or something. So they're completely off the wall. Like, it's just come out that Mr. Woodstra of the New King James Committee was a homosexual, so I think that's why he didn't know about curling irons or whatever. But of course, maybe he would know about curling irons. I don't know. Now, you might ask, what if you're not reading the Bible from the beginning? What if you haven't picked up a Bible for, God forbid, a week or two, and you forgot what the definition was for things? Does God define words all through the Bible? And the answer is yes, he does. Okay? Look at the word cunning. No, we don't use the word cunning today. But I looked up cunning in almost all of its usages. Okay? And in every usage, God defines it once again in case we forgot it. Now, he's going to define it with a different word to expand our vocabulary. So in Exodus, he defines cunning as wisdom. The OED defines it as wisdom. Okay? Kings, he defines it cunning as understanding. That's one of the Webster's definitions. Okay? And Chronicles, he defines it as skill. That's another one of the Webster's definitions. Okay, so everywhere you go in the Bible, God very likely will have a definition for you. Now, sometimes the definition for a word will change. Cunning is one of those words that can also mean crafty, or, you know, in an evil kind of sense. Well, when the meaning of the word changes, he will put the new definition right next to the word. Because in Ephesians, cunning craftiness, the OED defines cunning as also being crafty. So when the definition changes, he also changes the meaning of the word. Okay. Now, you know, you look at some of those measurements, units of measurement in the Bible, like a dram, and you think, well, I've got to get, you know, some $50 Bible dictionary to find out what a dram is, because that's something they used a long time ago. Well, after I started finding out how God defines things, I realized, well, he simply beats it into the ground, okay, in the chapter or in the verses. So I thought, well, I'm going to find out what word is beat into the ground in the chapter where the first usage of the word dram is. And I found out that he kept using the word hand over and over and over, okay? And so I said, well, it must have something to do with hands or something like that. So when I looked up what a dram was, it was the amount of gold or coins that could be held in a person's hand. That was the definition. And so God had beat the word hand sort of into the ground there in that chapter. So after a while, when you start looking for his built-in dictionary, you'll be able to find it yourself. Now, sometimes people look at the sentence structure of the King James Bible, and they think, well, maybe we could just change the sentence structure around. You know, unfortunately, there's a move even within our own fundamental circles thinking perhaps the King James needs updated or something like this, and we know it doesn't need updated. But when you start looking at something as simple as sentence structure, and when God uses a word like dispensation, okay, well, all the new versions don't like that word. They get rid of dispensation. They think, well, we can certainly call it stewardship, administration, commission. We can change it to three or four different things. Well, the King James is consistent. They use that word dispensation all the way through. And when you start breaking down the sentence structure of how they use it, of the gospel, of the grace, of, once again, is committed, is given, me. Okay? The sentence structure is even the same there. So God is helping us to understand things just through his orderliness in the way he approaches things. Now, this is
from the NIV or the New King James. The very same verses that I just showed you, we're looking at those in the New King James. And I tried to break them up some way, make some sort of order out of them. But they use stewardship. Now, they do use dispensation once, stewardship again. You can't break the sentence up in any orderly way. They throw in was, which is not in the Greek text. They don't follow the Greek word order in this sentence. The NIV is just as bad, perhaps not even worse. They throw words in that aren't in the Greek text. Three different words. So there's no continuity in how they're translating anything either. Okay. Now, another thing the King James Bible does that is very helpful in helping you understand the point God is trying to make is called fronting. And linguists use fronting to help people understand things. In any sentence, there are two kinds of thoughts. There's the focus of the sentence, and then there's the theme of the sentence. Now, normally, the theme comes first. If we say, this church is pretty, the theme is this church. The focus is pretty. I'm going to tell you something new. Normally, you put the focus at the end. But if you want to do fronting, if you really want to emphasize something important, you would say, you know, like on TV, they used to say, here's Johnny. Well, the normal way to say this, John is here. But here's was fronting. The King James Bible does that. And it's over the years, it has really helped me because I would see these imperative case verbs that would say, fear not. I said, well, Lord, I'm a mess. You know, I'm really full of fear and all these sorts of things. And he says, I told you, fear not, make it very simple, you know. But looking at it, at Hebrews 1:1, God, who? The very first word in Hebrews and the very first part of that is God who. Now, when you look at the NIV, it's in the past God. You know, somehow God gets the second row back seat there. Okay, then you move down in Hebrews 7:27, who. There you go again with the who. We're still talking about God. He's the important focus in this. Well, when you look in the NIV, unlike the other high priests, God lands up somewhere in the middle of the sentence. God starts a lot of sentences out with verbs. Follow, cast, casting, telling you precisely exactly what you have to do because that's our job, you know, doing exactly what, you know, he asks us to do. Now, the new versions, when you're just looking for omitted words in the new version, sometimes you'll miss the trickiness and the deceitfulness of what they're doing. For instance, the King James in John 3:15 said, whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life or eternal life. Okay. Now, if you simply take the word in him and move it, as the NASB does, to whosoever believes may in him have eternal life. If you do what the old English teachers used to make you do, you know, you had to take the sentence and see what's modifying what and all that sort of thing, you will find that the word no longer modifies what it modified in the King James. And what you have is that it starts modifying have, okay? The in him, have in him eternal life, okay? Not whosoever believes in him. Okay, they're changing the object of belief. They're teaching what's called inclusive theology in Roman Catholic seminaries and liberal seminaries, where they believe everyone is saved in Christ, whether you know it or not. You know what I'm saying? So everyone will go to heaven and everything will turn out wonderful. Now, look at Philippians 2:5. The King James is, who thought it not robbery to be equal with God? Now, the NIV says, who did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. In the KJV, not refers to robbery. In other words, it was not robbery for Jesus to say he was God. Okay, in the NIV, the not now modifies equality. He's not equal. Okay, so you have to look at very carefully when they start moving things around in these new Bible versions. Okay. I think I can turn this off now. And just say the rest regular. This is an IQ test, Mom. Failing it. Okay. I think the rest of the information I could probably give you without the machine. But very often to find out what words mean in the King James Bible, people will look at the back of Strong's Concordance, or they will get a Vines dictionary or some sort of Bible dictionary. And very often, because those sources were written by people who have a liberal mindset, or a mindset as far as their Christian lifestyle is much more liberal than what we think about today, you will not get God's definition. Let me give you an example. The word bless. Okay. If you look up the word bless in a Strong's Concordance, or if you look it up in a Vine's Concordance or one of these, it will say happy. So we have, who's Mr. What's his name that has the happy, the blessed are those? Schuller, right? Yeah. He has a book called Happy Are Those That This and Happy Are Those. Well, how many times in your Christian life have you not been happy and wondered, well, if blessed means happy and I'm not happy, I'm not blessed, and what's the problem here? Because if they define blessed as happy, well, when you look in the Oxford English Dictionary to find out what blessed really means, this is what it will say. Quote, to mark or affect in some way with blood, to make holy with blood, to save. That is the dictionary definition of bless. Well, now, we didn't need to know that. I mean, we didn't need that because we have a King James Bible. And when we look up in 1 Corinthians 10:16, where it's got the word blessing, it says, the cup of blessing which we bless is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? So right there, it's got blessing. Bless is blood. Okay? So the King James Bible has a built-in etymological dictionary to figure out what it is. And so we know that we are blessed because we have the blood of Jesus Christ on us. Now, another word that's interesting that they've changed around is the word gospel. Okay? The word gospel came from the Anglo-Saxon, actually the Saxon, God spell. Okay? So the word originally meant God and spell. And spell actually meant the letters were important. You know, Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega. God, spell God, God's spelling, or God's word. All right. Now, the liberals didn't like God, so they changed it to good. And they didn't like spelling or words, you know, the focus on the individual words. They liked the idea of a message. So it went from being God's word to good news or a good message. Or the good message. So God got dropped out. But actually, the etymological meaning of gospel is God's word. Now, if you didn't know etymology, or if you didn't, you know, bother to look up those things, Romans 10:16, gospel, word of God. 2 Corinthians 4:2-3, word of God, gospel. 2 Timothy 2:8-9, gospel, word of God. So God defines the gospel as the word of God. Now, the same thing, interestingly, happened when the Greek, if you start looking things up in the Greek dictionary, the word evangelist, they will say, well, that's a messenger, someone with a message. But actually, the EU of the Greek means God. You can trace it back to godliness. And the evangel, or the angel, actually meant word. So that also meant God's word. So they'd sort of watered it down where we had this idea that it means some sort of message. So an evangelist is a God's word person, you know? Okay. Now, people will often suggest to you that perhaps we could update some of the words in the King James. And you can buy Bibles today. Lots of ones are sold where they'll take some of those so-called archaic words, and in the margin, they will update that word. Well, I'd like to suggest to you that those updated words are wrong, and let me explain to you why they're wrong, and I'll give you an example. Bewray and betray. You will find both of those words in the King James Bible. The Bible uses both of those words. Now, bewray means to uncover something. Betray means to turn someone over. Okay, they don't mean the same thing at all, but you will look at it in these little Bibles that are going to tell you what archaic words mean. Bewray, well, that means to betray, and you think, well, that's what it means to betray. But if you look up in the Greek, it's got two different words. If you look it up in the Hebrew, it's two different words. If you get old Bibles, the old Spanish, it was manifesto and intrigado. In the Gothic, it was bandwipe and atgaban. It's always been two different words. But, you know, we're not word-oriented anymore in our culture. We're picture-oriented. So the differences in words like this, they're sort of lost. And I think, you know, if we would allow someone to take our King James Bible and start tampering with some of these words that do have specific, separate meanings, we would be greatly watering down the word. For instance, we don't use the word ensue anymore very often. We would say pursue, we would think. But if you look up the 89 instances of the word pursue in the King James Bible, they're all negative. Pursue is always a negative term in the King James Bible. Ensue is positive. You know, seek peace and ensue it. It was a positive term in the King James Bible. So they can't be updated. The one that you'll always hear, you know, the classics say, well, in the King James Bible where it says, we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. And everyone says, well, prevent means precede, okay, and that should be changed, and they'll put a little note, and you feel like you have this inferior, horrible Bible because it says prevent. It really should say precede, and you need to get a new King James or something. Now, prevent comes from the Latin venere, just means come, okay? Precede is sedere, go. Like when North Carolina seceded from the Union, go, okay? From God's perspective, when he calls us to meet him in the air, we are going to be coming to him. from the perspective of people who stay here, we will be going. Okay, so we know who wrote those new Bible versions because they think it means go. Now, you didn't have to know all venere and sedere. You didn't have to know all those things. Okay, you simply had to look at your Bible, look for the built-in dictionary. Remember what I said, we which are alive and remain unto the coming. Come. I said prevent means come. Well, the word is right in the sentence, so you didn't have to know that he's coming. Like alway and always. They'll put a little note and say, well, let's just get rid of all the alway. A-L-W-A-Y in the Bible. We'll make it always because, you know, that's just some weirdo way that they had of saying thing. Okay. Well, alway is accusative. Alway means all the way. Okay. It deals with space. Jesus said, lo, I will be with you alway. All the way, even to the end of the world. Okay. Always has to do with time. Okay. It's in the genitive. So there's two different Greek words there, but the New King James and the King James 21, they'll go, oh, alway. That must mean always. Let's just, you know, change that, get rid of that one. Now, there's something that I find really phenomenal in the King James Bible, and it has to do with its phonesthesia. Okay, phonesthesia. Each individual letter and its corresponding sound contributes to the emotional effect a word has. Now, if advertisers know all about this. Before I was saved, when I was in my 18, 19, 20 years old, I was an advertising major, and we were taught all these little tricks, and I got out of that even before I was saved because I thought it was a wicked thing to be doing. But they would teach us that words that had plosives in them. Plosives are T, D, K, G, P, and B. Okay, those words, when you pronounce those words, the air explodes in your mouth. They're very powerful words. So if you want to swear at someone, use an invective, call them a name, be mean, you will find that most swear words have what are called plosives. You hold the air in your mouth, you go P, and you let it explode out of your mouth. Or K, you know, the air comes out of your mouth. All right. So advertisers said what they would teach us. They said, well, if you want a product to sound harsh, call it Clorox, because it's got these two, you know, K sounds in it. Okay. Now, if you want it to sound soft, you call it Puffs. Okay. And they would teach us all these little tricks. And it's true. It actually works. You know what I'm saying? Now, God knew these psychological associations of words that we would have. And so, remember in Hebrews it says the word of God is powerful. Okay? So when God wants to be powerful, he will use these things that are called plosives. Okay? He also uses some other things. But like the word God, for instance, you can start with a G and ends with a D. I mean, he is all powerful. So his name in the English language is G and D. Power. Wow. Okay? Now, if you look in an NIV, 303 times they take the name of God out and they substitute the word sovereign. Okay? Now, sovereign are words, you know, as I was taught, that are very soft and gentle. And actually, it came out of the French court. And I don't know if any of you have ever seen pictures of Louis XIV, but you know what Louis XIV looked like. It was a very effeminate kind of a court. A lot of the words that came to us through the French language are very effeminate and gentle kinds of words. Now, that's good for words like mercy and grace. You know, we want words that are mercy and words like that that are gentle, that are communicating something gentle. But if we want to communicate something powerful, we don't want to say sovereign, okay? But the New King James, the NIV, 303 places will say sovereign Lord instead of Lord God, okay? God is much more powerful. And then when you think about it, the word sovereign was current for the King James translators. They use the word sovereign in the preface to the King James, in the dedication to the reader, and it called King James the sovereign Lord. And so if you trace back the use of the word sovereign to the 1100s when the Normans conquered England, it always meant a political leader. The sovereign Lord was a political leader. The word has never, I checked it through the OED, there's something called the Brown University Corpus of English Language. You can trace any word back and see how it's been used throughout history. Sovereign has never had anything to do with God. It has always been a political leader. I think it's very interesting now that we're looking for this God-man, this Antichrist, this political leader, that what they call King James, our sovereign Lord, is now what we have substituted in the NIV for the word God, you know, the powerful word. And when you think about it, a God is a God. A sovereign is, you know, the King of England or something like that. So really the person that brought it into our culture was Mr. Calvin. And he believed, you know, amillennial, postmillennial, bring the kingdom on the earth. Whoever is the head of the government is also, you know, the sovereign Lord kind of thing. So I think that's where that came in. But when I was talking about words having a psychological and emotional impact, I started looking at the the words in the Bible, that the D words, for instance. And I looked at all the D words, and I found that almost all the D words had a negative association to them. And I'll give you a list of just a few of them. Damage, damnable, danger, darkness, dark, debt, defeat, defile, Delilah, deprived, despair, devil, destroy, destitute, devour, disease, dragon, dungeon, dung, dying. I mean, the list goes on and on. And so God is building up this association in our mind of something that's somewhat negative when he's using a D word. So if, perchance, a New King James person would come along, they say, well, let's get rid of that word distraught or draught or disannul or despite or something like that, and let's put a modern word in there. That would break this pattern that God is creating just using D words in the Bible. Now, the other thing that's interesting, the Cambridge Encyclopedia of English Language talks about SN words. Being sort of negative in our culture, SN words. And so I analyze all the SN words in the NIV and the New King James and the King James. And God uses SN words as a negative kind of thing 40% more times than the other versions do. It's warning us. This is a negative association. He's trying to tell us this is going to be something negative. That Cambridge Encyclopedia also said that SL words usually meant something that was going downhill. Like you're losing something there with SL words. So here's what happens. The King James will have slothful, going downhill, slain, going downhill, slack, going downhill. Someone's slender, it's going downhill. Okay. But now here's one of the, you know, these translators on these new versions don't understand these emotional effects that sounds have. So instead of calling people who are saved servants, they call them slaves. Well, that's an SL word. In our culture, it's a downward move. Well, we're not going down. You know, we're servants of God from the heart. We're going up, you know. So little subtle things like this that I don't think these translators are thinking about. Now, the encyclopedia also said that SC words were kind of negative. So I started looking at all the SC words in the Bible, and I thought, well, they were negative too. Scamp, skull, scapegoat, schism, science, scholars, scribes, you know, God's got all that. And all these SC words were negative. And the only SC word, one word was good, and it was scriptures. In other words, there's one good thing, and the rest of it was all negative. But as soon as they start, you know, switching all those things around, you've got a mess. Now, some people will say, well, let's just update the spelling in the King James Bible. For instance, like in the King James Bible, ceiling is spelled C-I-E-L-I-N-G. And you think, well, now, certainly we could spell ceiling right. You know, everyone in third grade knows ceiling is C-E-I-L-I-N-G, and we at least need to, you know, update that spelling. I mean, anyone would agree to that. But I taught English as a second language to foreign-born people for about 3 years, and I recall that in Spanish, C-L-O-C-I-E-L-O, I-E means sky, ceiling, heaven, you know. In French, C-L-C-I-E-L means the same, sky, ceiling, heaven. Italian, C-I-E-L-O. So people learning English as a second language would see that word. They would recognize it immediately and say, you know, this is something that I'm familiar with. For instance, if you get rid of the word defaming. Okay, we don't say defaming anymore. But when you look up defaming in Spanish, it's just diffamar. In French, it's diffama. Italian, diffamare. Now, if you would go to, like, the New King James, mocking, how is someone using English as a second language going to recognize that word because it isn't from the same roots? English comes from Anglo-Saxon roots, and it's very easy to take a language that uses Anglo-Saxon words and create what's called a pidgin from it. A pidgin dialect is a dialect where you have someone like a missionary trying to interact with someone who has a completely different language, and they create this sort of half language between the two of them. And Anglo-Saxon words, real short syllables, they create great pidgin languages, and you really can't do it with some of the other, you know, Bible versions. Now, the last thing I want to mention to you, you know, I talked to you about the Word of God being powerful and the word God being a powerful God. And forensic stylonomy is something that was invented back in 1944. There's a gentleman named George Yule, and he wrote a statistical analysis of literary vocabulary. But what he did is he took the works of John Bunyan, and he compared how John Bunyan talked to another writer. And I suspect, and I wouldn't want to say who it was. It was a Mr. Macaulay, that he was not saved. But he found a certain pattern in this, so that he could take a work. After a while, he would see a pattern in how that person spoke, the words they used, and he could determine, well, did John Bunyan write this, or did Mr. Macaulay write this? By how many syllables they were, how many times they used an A or an E or whatever. But anyways, in this forensic stylonomy, they discovered that women use more syllables to say the same thing, more words to say the same thing. You notice how jabbery I am, you know? You know, maybe we're dumber and we just have to really rattle around up there or something like this. I don't know. But we do. We tend to use more syllables. Now, using that criteria, the NIV uses more letters per word, more syllables per word, more words per sentence. It's identical to what a forensic stylonomist would identify as a female voice. So I think what's happening with this NIV and this New King James is that people who are reading those are getting an effeminate, monistic, half he, half she kind of idea of God. They're getting this effeminate voice coming out of God. So it's the sovereign. It's not God, you know, that this hard kind of sound anymore. And I'll just close with this verse, what I think about the NIV and the NASB. 1 Kings 21:7-8, Jezebel wrote letters in Ahab's name and sealed them with his seal. And I think that's probably what's happening with the NIV and the New King James. I think Jezebel, with this effeminate voice, is, you know, pretending he's God. And, you know, I'm noticing this word come into the Bibles. It's the word human. And I laugh whenever I see the word human in the Bibles, because it's not men and women anymore. It's this human thing, some half-breed, you know, that's halfway between. Now, I don't know if any of you know Egyptian mythology, but in Egyptian mythology, there was Osiris, and he got married, and they had the child, and the child's name was Horus. And Horus was the first God-man. Okay, Horus was sort of the Antichrist pre-type Horus. Well, Horus had two other names. One of them was Hugh, H-U, and the other was Min. And that's where we get the word human. It means God-man. And so I see this coming into all these new Bible versions, the human this and the human that. You know, it's not the man anymore, it's not the woman anymore, how God created the male and female. It's human again. It's this God-man that they've created. So, thank you for your attention, and it's such a blessing being with you all today. Did you want me to stay here?
All right. You often wish you had the opportunity to ask a question. So we're going to take a few minutes now and take questions about different versions of the Bible. The question that you've got, if you raise your hand, I'll come to you and we'll ask the question. All right, Brother Wayne Jones.
Well, we understand that the King James, the Bible for the English people today. That's the way I understand it. But what is the difference between the earlier English Bibles, like the Geneva, the Great Bible?
I'm glad you asked that. That is a super question. Because people often say, well, you know, what happened? Why didn't God use the Geneva? I mean, was something wrong with that? And if he did have a Geneva before a King James, why couldn't we have a new King James after the King James? But what happened? English was becoming English. Okay, English evolved from Old Latin, Old French, and West Germanic, okay? And in England, in about 1585, if you heard a tape recording of how English was spoken back then, now, I don't mean they had tapes back then, but over at Oxford and Cambridge, they make people do this. You know, they say, now, how did it, was it pronounced? So you can get tapes of how things were pronounced then. If you heard a tape of how things were pronounced in 1585, you couldn't understand it at all. Absolutely not at all. Now, if you looked at the words, you can read a Geneva Bible, but you absolutely couldn't understand it at all. And I have a quote from one linguist that said it was in the period of James the First that English became English. Okay? So before English became English, you didn't need a built-in dictionary in the Bible. Okay? Because people were familiar with all these root words. Like, they'll take the word collops. Okay, well, who knows what collops are? You know, I mean, if I took a show of hands, no one would know what collops were. Maybe some butcher would know what they are or something. But collops are fat. Okay, now in the Geneva Bible, it just says collops, because wherever that word came from, and I'm not familiar with the origin or derivation of the word collops, wherever it came from, people were still speaking Latin, still speaking French. I mean, the government had just quit speaking Latin. All the books were in Latin. The government had just quit speaking French. You know, there was this debate, should we speak English? The government's speaking French. The scholars are speaking Latin. The common people were speaking this Anglo-Saxon, you know, kind of a thing. And so they would know what collops were. Now, as English was going to solidify and be actually English as we know it today, it needed that built-in dictionary. So the King James Bible and that usage of collops says collops of fat. So it defines fat for you. So English, so when I say, you know, was the Geneva Bible an English Bible, in essence it really was not. Because it's a very short compass of time there before, you know, when English was English. And then the other thing I say about the Geneva and some of those others, Tyndale and Geneva, you know, the Bible says that prophecy of Scripture is of no private interpretation. Okay, the primary definition of the word interpretation in the Bible, it's always used going from one language to the next. And so we can't have private interpretation of the Bible. Geneva was done by a gentleman named Whittingham. Tyndale was a one-man job. Okay, the body of Christ, the aggregate body of Christ has to agree on it. Okay, you know, the Lord gave Tyndale marvelous Bible, you know, and but the aggregate body of Christ had to say, is this the Bible? You know, what is the Bible? And so the King James translators were the first group who ever took the Bible, and the bishops and the pastors would take the readings that they were working on, and they would send these down. It would come down from the committee actually to the people. They would send them out, and they'd say, what do you think of this? What do you think of this? Well, no one ever asked you what you think of the New King James or the NIV, because it's not a part of the body of Christ. But the King James Bible was a creation of the body of Christ. Although you don't hear about that, but that, you know, in the history of it, that's really how it happened. I think when God does something once, you know, Jesus is the first and the last. And I think the King James Bible was really the first English Bible done by the aggregate body of believers. And he does it once, and then he doesn't ever have to do it again. You know, he does it absolutely correctly. I don't know if I answered your question or not.
Will you explain to us something about the translators that King James used to translate the King James Version versus the group that sit in on the translation of the NIV?
Okay. You know, it's interesting. The King James Translation Project was a 7-year project. The New King James was also a 7-year project. Now, the difference was the King James translators fasted for 3 years. Then they worked on the translation for the next 4 years. So they did prayer and fasting for 3 years. Well, the New King James translators, they just knew everything, and they just jumped right in there. They were just absolutely sure. Well, God wasn't in it, you know, because they didn't pray and fast. It was something they were doing with their own flesh. So you have people that prayed and fast. Their grandmothers, the grandmothers of the King James translator, were under the reign of Queen Mary. And Queen Mary was what you probably heard of as Bloody Mary. She killed all the Christians in the land. She was a Roman Catholic, and she killed everyone. So if you'd seen your grandmother killed by Roman Catholics, and you had to run and hide and all this sort of thing, you would be very, very sensitive to right and wrong, good theology and bad theology and all that sort of thing. Now, Bedwell and Boys and some of these gentlemen that were on the King James Translating Committee, Boys was supposed to have had all of the Greek writers, every Greek writer that ever existed in his home, okay? So if you want to find it out, you know, find out what was said in the Koine or the classical Greek, he would open up Aristophanes, Plato, Aristotle, you know, any of these writers, he would have all of their writings. He had all of their writings. Now, the translators today, and I've talked to some of them, I say, what do you have? And they say, well, we have Thayer's lexicon, or we have Kittle's lexicon. And I said, well, no, what does that have? And of course, I know what it has. What has a sentence out of Aristophanes? What has a sentence out of Philo? I said, well, you know, in other words, you haven't read all the works of Philo or Aristophanes to get the context, or you're just believing what this man says. And so these were men that were at that juncture in history where, I remember one of the King James translators, his mother said she spoke Greek enough to make the Grecians blush. You know, I mean, my mother didn't speak Greek, you know. And so it's like these people were raised in a completely different culture. A man was talking to me at a Bible conference. He was a professor of Greek at a seminary, and he was a very, very kind man, very honest. And he leaned over and he said to me, he said, you know, he said he didn't really know Greek. He was sort of faking it. He said, you know, we're the Gilligan's Island generation. Let's be honest. And I said, I know we are. That's why we need to leave the Bible alone.
Will you explain to our people why the NIV waters down the sin of sodomy?
Oh, okay.
That's on our, we have it on our law books today. Mm-hmm. When they came out with the version, of course, they watered it down. Will you explain to the folks probably why that happened?
Well, I think there's a reason why the NIV has an effeminate voice, why it uses more words per sentence, more syllables per word. Two people were very involved with that it would appear that they are homosexual. Virginia Mollenkott is a avowed lesbian, and she was the stylist for the NIV committee, and she's come out with a number of books. Is the Homosexual My Neighbor, Sensuous Spirituality. She talks about using tarot cards and contacting her dead mother. She said that God is neither male nor female. He is the One, capital O-N-E. So that's why the NIV uses the term the One instead of He. And if you look at an NIV, you will find out that the word He and Him And man, I believe, are omitted about 800 times. And in a number of instances, they'll take the Son out, the Son of God, all those masculine associations, and they'll just put the One in there, this neuter person. And Virginia Mollenkott said that the One is neither male nor female. So now we have this One in these Bibles. She said at a press conference a few years ago that Jesus was chromosomally female throughout his life. I mean, what a strange thing to say. So we've got people writing the Bible that believe these strange kinds of things. They did a study of, linguists did a study as a baseline, 1971, pre-NIV. How many times the word man was used in a million English words? And I believe it was 5 out of 5,000, something like that, or 12 out of 5,000. And it had gone down appreciably after the NIV. In other words, this difference, you know, men and women are different, okay? They saw that that was lessening and lessening and lessening as a part of the way the culture spoke. And so, you know, her being a stylist, now stylist is a person who does, you know, English grammar and all that sort of thing, but Mr. Martin Woodstra was the chairman of the NIV Old Testament Committee, and he was a friend of a group called the Evangelicals Concerned. Evangelicals Concerned is a pro-homosexual group, and the spokesman for the Reformed Christian Church said recently that it was believed among them that Mr. Woodstra was a homosexual. He died of liver disease, which I understand is something that's one of those diseases you get when you, you know. So.
Yes, sir.
When you burn the Bible, the word doesn't burn.
The question is, and I've heard this sometimes in a house fire, everything will burn up but the Bible.
I've heard that so many times. I've heard about car wrecks and the Bible doesn't burn. I don't know.
Yeah. You know.
He said heaven and earth would pass away, but his word wouldn't pass away. So.
Oh, really? That's true. Question.
Yes, in the last book of the Bible, Revelation, the Lord said he's coming back to take all of his disciples home. What day will that be?
Pardon me?
You don't know. you have a question?
I noticed that we had some children here in our church that brought the NIV Bibles and things like this. Mm-hmm. Some of the older Bibles they had in the front of it, they had a copyright in the front. And it stated in there that a person could not use more than 1,000 words.
Well, they said 1,000
at a time without getting written permission. I've noticed now in some of the ones that they brought, we got one and confiscated and gave them a good Bible, and it said 500 words now.
Oh, really?
And they had changed the quantity. But what does that have to do with the Word of God? If somebody wants to use the amount of Word of God, what did they have to do with it?
Right. Well, you know, the Bible says the Word of God is not bound. Copyright has to do with authorship. And so if God is the author of the Bible, it's not going to be copywritten, and this church can print Gospel of John's for all they want. But if you have a Gospel of John and you want to print it, you want to use more, normally the copyright law says 200 words. So they're giving a little bit of liberty. They're giving you 500 words. Well, you really can't go into all the Word and preach the Gospel with 500 words. You'd have to get permission. And I think I mentioned this morning that you'd have to get permission from Mrs. Disney, who's the head of the TV Guide, if you want to use some more words out of the TV Guide, or out of the NIV or whatever. It's the same thing.
Next question, anybody?
Psalm 12:6 says the words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified 7 times. Can you explain that purified 7 times?
You know, I really can't, to be honest with you, but because that would be teaching the Bible. You know, when I do, I can tell you the history of the Bible, I can tell you the English of the Bible, but I don't teach the Bible. When people ask me a question about the Bible, I always refer them to their pastor. And I say, well, I'm sure your pastor can explain that. I've heard various explanations about going through English, going through Syriac, going through Latin, and going through all those sorts of things. But exactly how that was done, I couldn't tell you.
This is the question I was trying to ask you this morning out in the hallway. You go to the local bookstore here, in just about any of them, and you can't hardly find a book written by a man who's alive today that uses the King James Version. You can find them 100 years ago. In your travels, is there a lack of scholarship among fundamentalists out there? Is that the reason? Is that the? And what are our alternatives as far as... for King James material, what are the alternatives out there for us, or in your opinion?
Okay. Now, the word scholar, I believe it's used twice in the Bible, once in a kind of a neutral way, and the other time in a negative way. Remember, it's one of those SC words? Okay, so God really didn't have anything too good to say about scholarship, but he did have a lot to say about meekness. Okay, the meek shall he teach his way. Them that keep thy law would understand the Bible. So I think we've substituted in this generation and time this cognitive understanding of things for a heart understanding and a heart obedience. So the meek will he teach his way. Those that keep the law would understand. And so it would be so much easier if you could just read a book and understand it and get it in through your head. But then Einstein would have been saved and all the smart people would have been saved. Okay. But God wants it to be a heart thing. And so then, you know, the least intelligent person of all that loves God with all their heart could have the most profound understanding of the King James Bible. So I don't see scholarship and, the Word of God coming together at all. I think it's really, you know, as we obey do have a right heart for him, he peels away like an artichoke different parts of the Bible, and we can see more clearly, you know, what we're doing. So it's our heart looking at the Word of God. So the scholarly thing, you know, I don't know. Now, I think so many of us Christians look at the media, the television, the bookstores, what do we see? And I think when God looks down from heaven, he doesn't see that at all. You know, he sees the cleaning lady at the church. He sees, those are the star Christians to him. You know, so Chuck Swindoll and some of these people who are the star Christians to us. And we wonder, why don't they understand about the King James issue? Well, that's our media mentality, you know, sitting in front of the TV every night. We think that, well, the TV is it, and who's on TV? Well, that must be, well, if he's a Christian, he's not a Christian, well, he must be a good Christian. Well, maybe God doesn't know or care about Chuck Swindoll at all, and he's, you know, there's some good godly pastors all around the country, I think, that are teaching and preaching the Word of God. Now, unfortunately, as you said, they're not writing books, but I've personally gotten to the point in my own personal walk with the Lord that I don't read any books at all anymore. I just read the Bible because life is so short. There's so much in it. I'm so embarrassed at my lack of understanding of what's there already that if I read other things, I find that the Lord, once you start, you know, using all these study tools and studying it that way, he will just open up so much to you that when you go to one of these commentaries, it's like, oh boy, the Lord's obviously not talking to that person because he showed me all kinds of things and he's not showing them, you know. So if you just stick within the confines of the Bible. The other reason I think that there are no fundamental leaders is because remember the Old Testament and Kings, they wanted a king. They wanted that intermediary between God and man. And the Catholic Church has that. I was raised as a Roman Catholic. Well, that's very convenient. He'll tell you what God thinks. You don't have to get clean and pure in your own heart before God. Just ask him what he thinks. Abdicate your mind and then just turn the tube on or something like this. And so God has just wiped out that intermediary. There are no fundamental leaders that you can look to necessarily and say, that person is absolutely perfect. I will listen to them and I won't have to read the Bible and think anymore. We really see, you know, there's a blank area there. And there are, you know, spots of people around the country that are doing fabulous jobs in their own churches, but no king, you know, like they wanted King Saul in the Old Testament. And God was saying, you have a king. He's the King of Kings, you know. And
this morning you said about the Thomas Nelson Publishers publishing the NIV, I think, and they had lost money. I just wonder what publishing company, tonight you mentioned that what they use is describing the words and all is not always right. What publishing company best puts out a study Bible? Is it okay. Schofield or,
okay.
Or who?
Now, I don't personally recommend study Bibles. I just like a plain text Bible that has no notes. You'll notice those little cross-reference notes. Almost every Bible, even the Cambridge, they're amillennial or they're postmillennial. So when you start getting the notes on Israel, then they'll turn into the church in the New Testament. I mean, they'll just go crazy. It's like that person who's ever is making those notes, they sure don't know the Lord. You know, it's like, how did that get to there? You know, that's like crazy. You know what I'm saying? So just a plain text Bible where you study it yourself. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Look up created in Strong's. Where is it? Well, in Ephesians, God who created all things by Jesus Christ. Well, in Genesis 1:1, if you were studying the word that way, you'd know that God, Jesus Christ created everything. That'd be great the first day you're reading the Bible to find out that Jesus Christ created everything. I remember when I was first saved and I found that out, I was real excited to find out Jesus Christ created everything. That was great. So basically, as far as people who are printing the King James Bible now, I really encourage churches that are supporting groups like Bearing Precious Seed that are printing Bibles or Lockhaven Foundation, or some of these church groups that are actually printing Bibles. I like to see the Bible in the hands of the church, because in order to impeach the witness, I think that's the word. I think Thomas Nelson is doing some tricky things. They have changed in their Thomas Nelson Bibles, in Acts or Hebrews, I think, it's Jesus. It's Jesus in Greek and it's Jesus in English. They've changed it to Joshua.
along to match the King James, to match the New King James, because the New King James denies Jesus in both of those places, makes it Joshua. Well, they've got King James Bibles they're printing now with Joshua in there instead of Jesus. Well, we can look at that and say, well, look, that doesn't matter. They're trying to impeach the King James Bible by changing those few things. Zondervan changes a lot of spelling and some of those elements. Cambridge keeps the standard international spelling. Oxford keeps the international spelling. You know, now, World and some of these other ones, I haven't checked all their spelling. I don't know, you know. But that, when there are typos in the King James Bible or people are changing things, that does not make it not the Word of God. It just means this one little publisher at this one point in time is messing up with this one little place. You know, that doesn't mean that, you know, we don't still have the Word of God.
Can you elaborate on the discovery of the mathematicians that discovered names embedded within the King James Version?
Oh, okay. Now, there was a study that came out a few years ago. It was in a book or magazine called Statistical Science, and I talked about it when I was here last time. And statisticians had found, and it had been reviewed by Harvard and Yale, I believe, statisticians, that they had found using equidistant letter sequences, that means equal jumps between letters, in the Hebrew text that underlies the King James Bible, they had found the names of people, the day they were born, they were died. And these unsaved Harvard statisticians said, well, you know, the chances of this happening are one in almost impossible. Now, the study that was done by Mr. Ripps is what I would call a scientific study. Okay, it has statistical significance. Okay, and you have to understand what statistical significance is. Now what's happened is this Mr. Drosden has written a book called The Bible Code, and it's an absolute fraud because he doesn't understand statistical significance. Okay, you can take an array of letters as big as a telephone book and you can make it say absolutely anything you want. It has to be statistically significant in the way they found it, so that these unsaved statisticians, when they start looking at it, they say, something's going on here. So I do believe that there's something going on in the Old Testament. Perhaps, you know, the Jews require a sign, the Bible says. Perhaps as the times of the Gentiles are getting over, the Lord is speaking to the Jews and saying, hey, look, the name of Jesus is right here. The blood of Jesus is right in Leviticus. You know, within a very short compass of letters, you can skip over letters in the Hebrew and it'll say the blood of Jesus in Leviticus, you know. But now this Mr. Drosden, I believe that whenever God does something, the devil has a counterfeit almost immediately, and then it's on the Oprah Winfrey show. You know, I mean, that's sort of what happened is with this this Drosden person. He's taken a corrupt Hebrew text, someone, and he's not saved. You know, the only people that can handle the Bible are the priesthood of believers, and he's not a saved person, so he can't translate. The person he's got translating, he'll take a word and he'll turn it into newspaper. It's like, well, no, that couldn't be newspaper, you know what I'm saying? And so he has just created a caricature, and then all the critics will come and say, well, this is ridiculous. You can get anything. Well, of course you can, using his methodology. And that's why Mr. Ripps, who came up with this original statistical study, has disenfranchised himself from some of these other things that are happening, because there is a difference when something is statistically significant in the way it was done. There's probably really something that's happening there. But when you talk about recent discoveries, one thing I wanted to mention before I, you know, not here anymore or whatever, they have just discovered something phenomenal at Magdalene University at Oxford. They had a fragment sitting there, and it had been sitting there for years, and someone finally took that fragment. It was an old Bible fragment, and they examined it. And this was in the London Times. It made the front page of the London Times. Of course, now, we often hear about it around here because, you know, in London, you know, they'll tell everybody, but we don't find out about things. But anyway, it was Matthew. And it was a little piece of Matthew, and they took an epifluorescent confocal laser scanning device, and they dated this thing, you know, looking at the pieces of paper, at 60 A.D. So this is now the oldest piece of the Bible. Now, 60 A.D., that could have been Matthew's original. You know, everyone's looking for the originals. Well, surprise, surprise, it matches precisely the King James Bible. It does not match the NIV. It proves the NIV and the New American Standard wrong. Now, there's a book called Eyewitness to Jesus by Dr. Carsten Thiede. He's an unsaved, I would guess, theologian or researcher. He's the one who helped prove all this. He's fighting with the people in Munster, Germany. They're the people that keep the Greek text of the Bible. And he's saying, well, now, gentlemen, you must be honest. We've proven this reading is the correct reading. You've got to change it. Well, they all know
That means that that's going to prove the Textus Receptus, the King James Bible, was correct all along. Here's the very oldest copy. The King James was correct. The NIV is wrong. And it's just one word, H-E-I-S, that isn't in there. But that it's got the NIV wrong in that place. And they're embarrassed. And so the people in Western Germany that are keeping the Greek text and all those people, they don't want any part of it, you know. They're saying that Greek text committee now is Mr. Martini. We talked about him last time. He's Carlo Maria Martini's most in line to be the next pope. And he's really in charge of that committee. And he said in his book, In the Thick of His Ministry, I just read it this year, he said, man could be divine. So there's that human again. You know, man could be divine. So you will see in the New King James, in the NIV, the word God disappearing, G-O-D, as a person. And it being replaced with divine as an adjective. Well, if man can be divine, then this divine whatever that they're talking about is the old Genesis chapter 3, ye shall be as gods. How do you get to be gods? Well, you say man is divine, then you change the word God to divine, and then man gets to be divine, gets to be God. You know, it's sort of a tricky thing there.
Take two more questions.
I understand the problem with the Strong's Concordance and the things like that, and I've got a Zodiades transliterated, and I can look sometime at his notes and say, well, you don't know what you're talking about.
Uh-huh.
But what? How do you reconcile, or how do you go to somewhere to find out, like, Jewish custom, where you see something like the parable of the lost coin or something,
uh-huh.
You don't really know the significance of that lost coin unless you know what the Jewish traditions and customs are. Is there a book or an author you can recommend that you can kind of read and right alongside that so you can understand that a little better, you know?
I don't know. I would be amiss to go outside the Bible. There's so much in there. When we're outside, we don't know if it's true or not. Do you know what I'm saying? Inside the Bible, we know it's true. So I would be more inclined to say something that I knew was true than something that... All these things that say, well, they did this and they did that. When you start looking back at who wrote these books, and you start... I'm writing a new book. The new book I'm working on is called The Language of the Bible. But it's going to have a section called The Language of the Devil in it. And I'm doing a history of the lexicon. And most people don't realize the Greek lexicons that everyone uses, and they'll open it up and say, well, the King James is wrong. You know, the word says this. Well, I'm tracing the history of these Greek and Hebrew lexicons. And I have found that... The definitions have changed. If you look at, I have a Greek or a Hebrew Greek, two different ones, from 1600s when the King James translators wrote. It says what the King James Bible said. 1700s, the Unitarians started getting in there. The Transcendentalists started getting in. Well, they changed it. And then 1800s, they changed it again. It got progressively. Well, how did this Greek word that is in this frozen koine, because no one speaks koine, how did this Greek word all of a sudden get a new definition, a secularized definition? Well, no one has these old lexicons anymore to read this. So I started reading the history of the lexicon, and I found that there was this great revolt. Are we or are we not going to use quotations from philosophers, pagans? And they had never used them. Until, about 1725. Then they started using these quotes from pagans. When you start using quotes from pagans, you know, it says to the Greeks' foolishness. So the most brilliant Greek philosopher, the things of God are foolishness to him. So we're going to go look at these pagan authors and see what they believed, you know, about things. So you know, I don't know. I don't have that problem where I have to stand up and teach all the time. So I think if I did have that problem where I was teaching, maybe I'd go and start getting other things, you know, I don't know.
One last question from somebody that hadn't answered a question. Ask a question.
I hear there's 64,000 changes from the Bible that the NIV has taken took about 64,000 things out.
Right.
Is that pertaining to anything that leads to salvation?
Most definitely, it does. You know, we talked about this morning, through his blood, it's taken out of the NIV. The NIV teaches progressive salvation. The New King James teach progressive salvation. There's a book called Catholic and Christian by Mr. Schrock. And he's a Roman Catholic priest. And in that book, he said, when someone, a fundamentalist or a Christian, comes to your door on Saturday morning and they have a little tract in your hand and they say, would you like to come to church with us? Are you saved? He tells them what you're supposed to say. You're supposed to say, I have been saved at baptism and I am being saved
through my good works and through the sacraments at the church, you are being saved. So in the NIV and the New King James, they have changed you are saved to you have been saved or you are being saved. So they give this notion of progressive salvation. We have the instances of people being saved, the eunuch, the woman at the caught in adultery, all those, they've changed those. So they're not saying Lord Jesus anymore. It's very hard to be saved to give your heart to someone that you don't know or you can't see. And we see Jesus Christ through the King James Bible. When they change the face of Jesus Christ by taking words out, this and that, you know, he's not God anymore, he's sovereign, and it's not Jesus Christ, it's just Jesus, and it's not God manifest in the flesh, it's he who was manifest or something like this. They're changing the face of God. How can a person give their heart and life to someone? How can they receive that person as their Savior if you have this muddled view of who, or that picture of who that person is? So it's not just the verses on salvation, it's the picture of God in the Bible.
Mrs. Riplinger, do you know how many different versions of Bibles are out there today?
Publishers
recently said there were 450 translations and four are parts. 450.
The same amount as the
prophets of Baal. Okay. Let me say this, the bottom line. If you take the 450 and stack them up right here, all of them, you've got to remember they came from somewhere. Somebody just didn't reach up in the air and write them. There was a text they came from. Let me tell you, the bottom line is all of these came from the same text. You come over here on this side and you put the King James Version by itself, stack it over here on the table by itself. It also came from a text. But the text it came from had absolutely nothing to do where the text these came from. You need to remember that. That will simplify it. The text that these came from didn't even agree with themselves. This text is in agreement. This was the line that God supernaturally preserved from the time he gave his word. Now, I do not know of a modern revival, a moving of God anywhere in the world as a result of these 450 translations. You can read documentation, secular documentation, and find that God has supernaturally used the King James Version to bring about great spiritual awakenings, great revivals. But you cannot find a spiritual awakening from these texts. Westcott and Hort cursed the Textus Receptus. They said the vile Textus Receptus, that from which the King James came from. They hated the Textus Receptus. They didn't even consult it. They cursed it. That's the reason their line of so-called Bibles has got the curse of God upon it. Now, we hear a lot about revival, and they talk the message, but the crowd that's talking the message, if you watch them on television, they look like the world. It's never changed their life. It's never changed their appearance. It's the same old garbage, just different terminology. It's the same side ditch with the same muddy water, just different language. But you come over here and you find the one that God has supernaturally preserved. There's power in that book. Now, you've got to realize something else. And I want you to remember this. From the earliest point of my life, I memorized the King James Version. Through the years, I've tried to commit it to memory. What are you going to do? How are you going to teach your children the Word of God when if you teach them a version other than the King James Version, next year it's going to be changed and you're going to have to reteach them again what that particular verse says. You're going to have to reprogram your kids every year with a different version, because the version that says something this year is going to tell you something else next year. Why not just get a version and have your children to memorize that that don't change? I mean, it doesn't make a lick of sense to me. I mean, use your head, a woodpecker does. It don't make a bit of sense to get a version that's always changing, always changing, always updating. You don't need that. The Bible, King James, has proved itself to be the Word of God. Now, we need a revival in our churches around the Bible. I am utterly amazed at the ignorance of preachers and pastors across this country. They will have the authority to stand up, the audacity, not the authority, the audacity to stand up and say, for instance, the NIV and the New King James and all of that is closer to the oldest manuscripts. Well, anybody that's done any studying at all know that they speak of not truth. And they reveal their ignorance when they make a statement of that magnitude. But it sounds learned. And so people say, our pastor don't use the old archaic King James. He uses the version that's closest to the manuscript, oldest manuscripts. Well, if you want to go to Rome and become a Catholic, you can start using some of those. But by the way, they're not the oldest. They're not the oldest. It sounds learned, but they're not the oldest. I think what we need to do is just close down about 98% of our colleges and universities and just send those professors to a good school and let them learn what the Bible is and where it's at and what it says. Get them reprogrammed so they can go back and teach the next generation where the Word of God is. Listen, parents, you make sure when you send your kids off to school that they go to a school that believes the Bible is the Word of God. When I say Bible, I'm talking about the King James Version. Now immediately, and I'm through, we're staying a little longer tonight because we need this, but immediately somebody, and I said this earlier, they're going to brand you fanatical and out of tune, out of touch, and they're going to say you're a bunch of nuts if you believe that. But that's all right. You tell them you're screwed on the right bolt. That's okay. You may be a nut, but you're screwed on the right bolt. But if they say you're narrow-minded, you say, that's all right. Jesus said you had to be narrow to get through the gate. So that's all right. You tell them that. But don't let somebody with a Ph.D. on the end of their name convince you that they're right and you're wrong if they don't believe the Bible is the Word of God. A Ph.D. on a liberal's name does the same thing for him spiritually that a curl in a pig's tail does for the ham. Absolutely nothing. Our Father, thank you tonight for these few minutes together. I pray you'll help us to generate a new love for your word. Thank you, Lord, that it's forever settled. Multitudes may try to change it, but Lord, we're going to face your word. And Lord, when we face your word, help us to so have lived here that we will face it unashamedly. And we will face it having had conviction to believe your word is indeed trustworthy.